5 minutes, yes, thank you. So now the second aspect, which would be important, interesting, and necessary to be understood, is that what kind of relationship Islam wants to maintain with the non-Muslims for the keeping of peace in this world. Islam wants to establish peace all over the world. And Islam wants a good, peaceful interaction. Islam wants establishment of a society, peaceful society, and Islam wants to establish an atmosphere of peaceful coexistence. That's why the basic thing is, you know, the olden days, as now in everywhere, in some countries, for example, if there are Muslim countries, then non-Muslims are living there as minorities. So Islam has given the teachings for them, for the Muslims. Not only the governments for the Muslim common people, where the non-Muslims are living with them, or other countries, Western countries, where Muslims are living as minorities, wherever the non-Muslims are living as citizens. So what kind of interaction, what kind of behavior is required by Islam for a Muslim to adopt? First of all, Quran says, "Man qatala mu'ahadan lam yarih rahiyat al-jannah." This term means any non-Muslim citizen. He says, anyone who kills a non-Muslim citizen, that Muslim will never smell the fragrance of paradise. This hadith is reported by Abdullah ibn Umar and narrated by Imam Bukhari in Kitab al-Sahih and Imam Muslim in al-Sahih. Hadith muttafaq alayh. Then Holy Prophet said, at another occasion, "Harram Allah alayhi al-Jannah." Almighty Allah will make paradise forbidden for him. The person who kills any non-Muslim citizen, of course, who is a non-combatant, any non-Muslim civilian, and who is not combating with you. So the Jannah would be forbidden for that Muslim who is the murderer and killer of non-Muslim. Again, Holy Prophet, peace be upon him, said, in a warfare, in a battlefield, Holy Prophet saw a woman, she was slain. He found a woman slain. So this hadith is reported by Abdullah bin Umar. Holy Prophet asked, "Who has killed this woman, this lady?" Nobody took the responsibility, it was done. Holy Prophet said that فَنَهَا رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ عَنْ قَتْلِ النِّسَاءِ وَالصِّبْيَانِ. He said that killing of women, even during warfare, the time of just war, is forbidden in Islam. Then again, Holy Prophet said the second thing, narrated by again Sahih Muslim, that فَلَا تَقْتُلُ الصَّبْيَانِ. In the same way, the killing of children has been made forbidden for Muslims. During warfare, even in the battlefield, a Muslim soldier during a just war, lawful warfare, is not allowed to kill any children, a child. Then Holy Prophet, peace be upon him, stated, "La taqtulu shaykhan faniyan, wala tiflan, wala saghiran, wala mra'atan." Do not kill any feeble old man, or any infant, or young child, or woman. Again, this hadith is reported by Imam Abu Dawood, narrated by Anas ibn Malik radiallahu ta'ala anhu. This was the standard given by Holy Prophet. Then Holy Prophet said, "Wala ashab as-sawame." He said, "La taqtulu ashab as-sawame." Even during warfare, when a proper lawful battle is going on, during lawful, do not kill those who tend to the monasteries. And he said, do not kill the monks and priests. So killing of priests, monks, and those who are worshippers and are tended to the monasteries, killing of those people even during lawful warfare is prohibited by Islam. And again Holy Prophet said, "Allah la yuqtalu rahibu fi sawmi'ah." And same was declared by Sayyidina Abu Bakr and all guided caliphs. Beware, no non-combatant priest tending to his monastery should be killed in any case, even during a just warfare. Then Holy Prophet prohibited Abdullah ibn Mas'ud reports, and Imam ibn Abi Shaybah has narrated the hadith. He said, Holy Prophet, وَاتَّقُوا اللَّهَ فِي الْفَلَّاحِينَ. Holy Prophet said that you cannot kill the farmers and fear God regarding the farmers. Farmers, they are the person who provide economy to a society. So during the warfare, the farmers are not allowed to be killed. Holy Prophet said, the merchants and traders are not allowed to be killed even during warfare. Imam Ibn Abi Shaybah narrates, and Zaid bin Wahab stated that Sayyidina Umar radiallahu ta'ala used to write the letters to the soldiers and to the commanders of the armies regarding this. Ittaqullah fil fallahin fala taqtuluhum. And Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam stated, and this was the practice of the companions, and they said, la yuqtalul harrasu iza ulima annahu laysa min al muqatala. Qala, farmers are not to be killed during war if it is known that they are not the combatants. So basic principle has been laid down. Whether there is a woman, lady, there is a children, there is an old sick person, there is a farmer, there is an agriculturist, there is a grower, he is a trader. None of them, even the diplomats and ambassadors, are not allowed to be killed, because these are non-combatants. So basic principle was laid down that no Muslim soldier during warfare is allowed to kill any single non-combatant non-Muslim. When two countries are at war and a warfare is going on, so during that time the non-combatants are not allowed to be killed. What to talk of the time of peace? What to talk of killing those non-combatant civilians who are totally not involved in warfare and who are working in their twin towers, who are working in their marketplace, who are sleeping in their houses, who are working in their embassies, working in their offices, and they have absolutely no practical concern with warfare going on between two countries. So what Islam would say about those people who kill non-combatant, innocent civilians working in their houses, in a case where Islam does not allow killing of non-combatants during the warfare or during the battlefield? This was the concept. Then the Quran says, the injured person or prisoner should not be killed, and the one who flees should not be pursued, because he has shown his unwillingness of fighting. He is not going to be combatant, so he is not allowed to be killed. So this hadith is again reported by Musannaf Abdul Razzaq, and Sayyidina Ali bin Abi Talib is the reporter of hadith. And then just imagine the situation when the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, after 8 years of immigration, he entered Mecca as a successful leader, and Mecca was captured. And the Meccans, they were those who were imposing wars on Medinans and on Medina and Holy Prophet, peace be upon him, every year. And every single war which was fought by Prophet Muhammad and his companions, that was the war of defense. If we study the seerah, the whole life history of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, none of the wars which were fought, he was never initiated in a single war. None of the war was fought as a war of aggression. Every single war which Prophet Muhammad was involved in was the war of defense. The first war was fought always near city of Medina, Badr. Second war of Uhud was fought on the border of Medina. Third war of trench was fought on the border of Medina. So every single war which Holy Prophet, peace be upon him, was forced to enter into, he was never an initiator. He had to respond as a war of self-defense. When he entered in Mecca, there was no bloodshed. The people who had been enforcing and imposing the wars every year on Prophet of Medina, and he never allowed him to live a peaceful life there. So they were afraid. They thought this is the day of revenge for them. So Holy Prophet heard these voices and he said, Man dakhala dar abi sufyana fahuwa aminun. وَمَنْ أَلْقَ السَّلَاةَ فَهُوَ آمِنٌ وَمَنْ أَغْلَقَ بَابَهُ فَهُوَ آمِنٌ. This hadith is reported by Abu Huraira and quoted by Imam Muslim in As-Sahih. Holy Prophet said, whoever enters Abu Sufyan's house, he is safe. And Abu Sufyan was the leader of Meccans, always, who had been the initiator of wars on Medina. The biggest enemy of the Holy Prophet for the last 8 years, Holy Prophet chose the house of the biggest enemy of Islam up till there, before embracing Islam. He said, whoever enters the house of Abu Sufyan and finds shelter in my enemy's house, he is safe and secure. Whoever lays down his weapon, giving a message of peace, he is safe and secure. Whoever shuts his door, giving the message that he is not ready to fight, he is safe and secure. Holy Prophet said, La tasriba alaykum al-yawm, izhabu fantum utulaka. Today nobody is going to take any kind of revenge from you. All of you are forgiven. This was the official announcement of Prophet Muhammad on the day of success of Makkah, or the capturing of Makkah. In the same way, Holy Prophet, peace be upon him, then stated, so these instructions were given. And Sayyidina Abu Bakr Siddiq used to say, Inni usika bi ashrin, the first guided caliph used to say, La taqtulu, I command you to observe 10 things. These were the official instructions given by Holy Prophet, given by the first caliph Abu Bakr, by Umar, by Usman and Ali. All the four guided caliphs of Holy Prophet used to be upon him. When they used to send the armies, these was a given official package of instructions, package of peace. Even during warfare, a package of peace. And officially it was read and announced in the battlefield before the initiation of war. They used to say, I command you to observe 10 things. Do not kill a young child. Do not kill a woman. Do not kill an elderly infirm man. Do not cut down fruit bearing trees. Do not demolish the buildings. Do not slaughter a sheep or camel except where necessarily needed for food. Do not drown or burn date palm trees. And do not steal from the war booty. These were the instructions, the full package of peace. If the package of peace is compulsory to be observed during the warfare, what would be the condition of Islamic stance in the normal condition of life, in interaction of Muslims and non-Muslims, in Muslim lands or non-Muslim lands? And Holy Prophet, peace be upon him, wrote down an official letter to the people of Najran. They were Christians. And he said, indeed, Najran and her allies, this letter of Holy Prophet has been reported by Imam Abu Yusuf in Al-Kharaj, Kitab Al-Kharaj, Imam Abu Ubaid Qasim bin Salam in Kitab Al-Amwal, and Imam Ibn Sa'd in Tabaqat, and Ibn Zanjawiy in Kitab Al-Amwal, and Balazri in Futuh Al-Buldan. Every single reliable, authoritative source of Islamic history has carried out this, reported this letter. Holy Prophet said, indeed. So here lies the whole concept of Islam regarding the peace, interaction with other communities, with the non-Muslim communities, providing the peace and security to them, and safeguarding their every kind of religious, social, economic, political right. Holy Prophet said, Najran indeed, Najran and her allies are under the protection of God, and the guaranteed protection of the Messenger of God. And he said, they are to be protected, he wrote down the letter, protected in their wealth, in their lives, in their lands, and in their religion. This includes their priests, monks, and those who are present amongst them, and those who are absent at this time, and all of their delegations and the like. They shall not be forced to change their faith. They should be freely allowed to practice their faith, which they have already owned. And no right of theirs is to be forfeited. No monk or priest or attendant amongst them should lose his job, should lose his possession, should lose his wealth and right. And he said, be it plentiful or scarce, and no fear or danger will threaten any single person belonging to non-Muslim community. This was the letter of guarantee which Holy Prophet used to send to all communities, non-Muslim communities. Same was the practice carried on by Sayyidina Abu Bakr. Same practice was carried on by Sayyidina Umar. Same was the practice carried on by Sayyidina Umar and Sayyidina Usman and Sayyidina Ali. A beautiful letter sent by Sayyidina Umar, the second guided caliph of Holy Prophet, peace be upon him, I would like to quote. And it has been reported by Imam Ibn Jarir Tabari. He said, Sayyidina Umar says, and he said to the Christians of Ilia, Tabari course, he said, they are granted safety of their lives, their property, their churches, their crosses, and all their religious relics. No one should ever destroy their churches or decrease any portion of it or desecrate their crosses or confiscate their property or hate them for their religion, or nobody is allowed to harm them or to harm any of their followers. This was an official letter used to be written to every single non-Muslim community. And again, Khalid bin Walid, the commander, acting as the governor of a province, on the instruction of second caliph Sayyidina Umar, he issued an official letter, an announcement to the people of Anad. They said, the Christians community here may blow their naqus, their music, religious music, at any time they please to do, either during the day or night, except at the time of the five daily prayers of Muslims, not near their mosques. They might, if they like, take out the processions of their crosses wherever they want in Muslim lands, and they, during their religious festivals, so there is no barrier on them. This is the letter written by Khalid bin Walid, the governor. And the same, the caliph of Umayyad caliph, Walid bin Abdul Malik, in his days, a part of church was forcibly annexed to a portion, the church, the Christian cathedral. It was forcibly annexed to a mosque. It was reported afterward, this act of injustice, the scholars raised their voice. But when Umar bin Abdul Aziz, it was reported to him, and he came, Umar Abdul Aziz, he wrote his letter, official letter, to the functionaries, and he said, pull down the portion of the mosque. Demolish the portion of the mosque which once belonged to the cathedral, and the land was finally handed over back to Christians, and that portion of the mosque was demolished. These were the practices always carried on, and it was a continuous practice of the Prophet and continuous practice of the companions of Holy Prophet and their guided caliphs in their times. And the same practice was followed throughout. Now,